psychology is a subject which obviously is a huge part of the world that we're transitioning into now. I'm sure most of you, you're here at this talk, you're probably aware of what we're calling the singularity. The world is massively changing. New technologies are going to completely shape the way our future on this planet. And I think it's really important within our movement that we don't allow all that technology to be built by corporate profit-making machines, that's all they want to do is make profit. As a culture, we need to be doing everything we can to make sure we participate in creating this future world. Without further ado, I'm going to introduce the panel. So this panel is called Cryptopsychedelic, the Intersection of Psychedelic Science and Blockchain Technology. We have our presenter, Mike Margolies. Mike is a connector in the psychedelic space and heads up the Baltimore Psychedelic Society. So this panel, psychedelic science today is revolutionizing mental health care. And at the same time, blockchain technology is completely changing all kinds of things, economics and all kinds of other systems. We now have the possibility to have decentralized human organization for the first time. So this panel is going to ask the question, where do these two trends meet? And so this talk is for all you crypto nerds who are psychedelically inclined. And for all you psychedelic explorers who are interested in adventuring into the crypto galaxy. So, please welcome our space pilot, Mike Margolies, who's going to present the panel.
Hello, hello. Welcome, everyone. Thank you for being here. And I'm going to pass these mics out. Welcome to the Crypto Psychedelic panel. And thank you for that introduction. I'm Mike Margolies, co-founder with Matt here of Crypto Psychedelic, which started off as a conference that we produced in Tulum, Mexico in February, where we decided to combine these worlds of the psychedelic community, which I've been actively engaged in over the last several years, producing events in media, and building various communities. And Matt's also been working in the blockchain world. He'll give his own intro in a moment. And we decided, how can we collide these worlds to, as Liana said, see what brain babies can be made. And in the months since then, we have come up with a lot of brain babies. So I'll let our other panelists introduce themselves, and then we'll get into this exciting topic.
Awesome. Thank you, Mike. I'm Matt McKibbin. I'm a founder of a company called Decentranet, which does ICO and blockchain consulting for new types of startup projects to figure out how they can best utilize this technology, as well as a co-founder of Crypto Psychedelic. I think that these two technologies fundamentally go hand in hand in more ways than we can even understand, and it's going to take an hour and a half to really unpack it for you. So I'm really excited to do that.
My name is Mareesa Stertz. I'm a filmmaker. I have a documentary series with Mary Jane at Snoop Dogg's media company. And I have taken on helping introduce psychedelics to the public, to the mainstream world, and make sure that the framing of it is done in an intentional way so that the public understands how we are using these and how this has the potential to help heal traumas, help us emotionally process the things we've been grown up from systems that haven't served us. And it's really exciting to explore how blockchain technology can help facilitate this process.
My name is Joel Dietz. I'm a professional ninja. part of my work is educating people on how technology is going to influence the future of finance. I was a founding contributor to the Ethereum project, and I continue to invest and advise a lot of different projects in the crypto space.
Hello, everybody. My name is Liana Sananda Gillooly. I've been involved in the drug policy reform movement for the past 8 years. I worked on several different cannabis legalization initiatives, and I'm currently work for the Multidisciplinary Association for Psychedelic Studies, also known as MAPS. MAPS is in phase 3 trials right now with the FDA, and we are pushing through MDMA-assisted psychotherapy in the United States. We're also looking at taking our research to Europe and around the world, and there's a lot of exciting things happening there. So thanks for being here.
Thank you all for being here. All right. Cool. So I'm guessing people in the audience here have various degrees of knowledge around both of these topics. Maybe some of you are already pretty versed in crypto or psychedelics or vice versa, or maybe you don't know anything at all, but it just sounded interesting. So before we really get into the what are the intersections, we want to give a really brief overview, a kind of like a 101 of blockchain and the state of the union of psychedelic renaissance. So we'll start with like blockchain, and Matt and Joel maybe can speak to give us a little overview of, you know, hey, what's blockchain, cryptocurrency?
Yeah, so I like to go back. I call this my kind of like the Uber driver explanation, because when you're traveling around the world and you're in a lot of different taxi cabs, they often ask like, what do you do? And when you say Bitcoin and cryptocurrencies, you have to give a 5-minute explanation, right? So I go back to kind of the beginning of the internet. We had a lot of different ways where we were able to transfer information, and we were design systems that were made it easy for everyone to transfer systems of information, packets of information, from one peer to another on a network. And that's what the internet is based on, is all these different computers connected together where we can trade packets of information. Blockchain technology allows us to do the same thing, but with value exchange. So we have the internet of money, which allows us to take the power of creating different types of currencies and currencies and economies, and bringing it away from centralized organizations such as corporations or banks or governments, and putting it back into the hands of the people, of distributed collaborative organizations or distributed autonomous organizations if they're autonomous. Fundamentally, this technology allows us to disintermediate lots of different centralized hierarchies that might have control over our money, but also how we govern and organize our society. And so that's the fundamental real thing of what blockchain does, is allows us to take control over what we do with our money in the same way that the internet did with information.
I piggyback off that and rewind even farther in history and saying that blockchain as a technological innovation is a lot like the printing press was at a particular moment in time. And many of you are probably familiar that you basically at that time had monks that would handwrite the Bible in Latin, and then they would put it in a church. And then if you could read Latin, then you could maybe figure out what was going on. Otherwise, you didn't really have a clue. And the printing press was a massive game changer because suddenly people could print things in their own language, they could have opinions about things, they could spread their opinions, and it took a particular power infrastructure that had been set up and was maintained by a few people for the benefit of those few people, and it actually flipped it over to giving people direct ability to have control over their own thoughts and opinions. And I think that right now, with respect to the banking system, it's exactly the same thing. The banking system is set up by a few people to benefit a few people, and they have no interest in changing the way that infrastructure is. And blockchain technology is a way of radically empowering individuals to create their own systems.
Mm. Yeah. So one thing I'd add to that, and actually correct me if I'm misrepresenting this at all, but I like to describe when people ask about cryptocurrency, you know, today if I was to PayPal you money, how do we figure out that I have the amount of money in my account that I'm trying to send to you? So we in today's current system rely on a third party to say, oh yeah, you have this money that's checking the ledgers. And in one thing that blockchain is doing is it's taking that ledger and it's distributed. So we don't need it. So the way, the how of how it does this thing, how it disintermediates this need for the third party is the ledger is now distributed. So you don't need a third party banking system to say, oh yeah, you do have this money because it is communally owned. I hope that's a fair way of representing it.
Decentralized trust networks.
Decentralized trust networks, mm-hmm. Exactly. And this has applications beyond just money, and we'll get into more of this. So the other thing I want to also give an overview on is kind of the state of affairs of what we're calling the psychedelic renaissance. And so, yeah, Mareesa, Liana, would you like to kind of give where we are?
Absolutely. Yeah, we're living in the most exciting time ever for in the terms of the acceptance of psychedelics as medicine globally. So one of the reasons why I think we're seeing such a mainstream acceptance is, and it's not mainstream everywhere, but I have witnessed a seismic shift in America in the past 8 years in terms of how people are approaching psychedelics as a therapy. And one of the main reasons is that there hasn't been any breakthrough in mental health since the creation of SSRIs 30 years ago. And so the FDA has declared MDMA-assisted psychotherapy a breakthrough treatment, which is a special designation, which means that they're essentially fast-tracking us through, and we're going to have access to these treatments as soon as 2021, with psilocybin currently in phase 2. And we're living in a world right now, I mean, can you imagine if there was no advancement in certain other types of science or investigation into cancer in 30 years, people would be freaking out. And psychiatry has been a totally stagnant field for a very, very long time. And so now we're seeing this global renaissance happening. We're seeing people who are very buttoned down and who don't have a traditional background in psychedelics, psychiatrists, department heads, all these people coming in and looking at our results. And our results are profound. We're talking 68% of people with intractable, incurable PTSD who suffer an average of 17 years are being cured. They no longer qualify from PTSD. And you don't see that kind of wording in psychiatry journals, in peer-reviewed psychiatry journals. No one's talking about a cure. It's all about how to maintain and live with the state or the condition that you have. And so the power of psychedelics to get to the root cause of our problems and really unearth that and cause seismic shift and transformation in our own mental healing is profound. And so MAPS has done a lot of work. And MAPS is not the only organization. There's several other organizations. The Beckley Foundation in Europe has done the most amount of research into LSD. We have the Hefter Research Institute. We now have USONA in the United States, who we're collaborating with on research into psilocybin. So we're seeing this growing, emerging movement happening. And it's because it works. And so one story that I like to relay to people to show just how much times are changing is that back in May, Fox News ran a report on our research. And the host was talking about how ridiculous it is that there's all these drugs that are legal and available that can absolutely kill you. And psychedelics, in large part, can't kill you, and they've been totally demonized. We haven't investigated their therapeutic potentials, and that's ridiculous. And they open up into a 5-person panel on Fox News, the most conservative media outlet on the planet, you know? And they're joking with themselves, oh, do you believe we're running a positive story on ecstasy right now? And they're all laughing and everything. And it goes to show that the times are changing. And one of the methods that we've done as well is we're working with veterans. So that one of the primary populations that we've been treating their PTSD is veterans. And so we're looking at building those bridges and onboarding people who wouldn't normally be interested in this type of work. And so with that, we're seeing all this change happen. And we're also, the science is so good. We're doing really stringent science, and science is on our side. Science is proving what we all already intuitively know. And so that's a really exciting thing as well.
I just want to add that it's really interesting that we have systems, especially in the States, we have physical education programs, we have personal hygiene programs, but we have no programs that teach us emotional well-being and emotional processing, and this is what psychedelics do. They help us blueprint how to unfold these experiences that we were never properly taught how to process. As kids, we're told, honey, don't cry, don't be sad, don't be angry, you know, behave. We're told to shut down our emotions. These tools help us unfold this, and this is such an essential part of what we need to unpack to be fully actualized human beings that live in cooperation.
Thank you. So the most common question that I get asked when I tell people about crypto psychedelic is, what do crypto and psychedelics have in common here? What do these two things have anything to do with each other? And so to start with, and we've been thinking about this exact question for a few months now, so we have a lot of answers here, both going forward into the future and also actually presently and in the past, there is a lot of already existing connections. So I'd love to just ask everyone to chime in here. What are some of the existing connections already between these two communities?
Absolutely. Well, so one of the first, I don't know, say apps, the applications of using of Bitcoin specifically was an online psychedelics or drug market called the Silk Road, which allowed for everyone around the world for the first time to really have quality assurance by having thousands and thousands and thousands of people review what types of substances were being shipped around the world and having a way of paying for that thing. So that in the beginning, the first real application of Bitcoin before it was what it is now and before it spawned all these other types of currencies, it was that it was allowed for anonymous marketplaces where you could, for the first time, kind of have quality control. You wouldn't want to, like, if you go down to your average, you know, drug dealer on the street, you don't know what you're getting. You have no way of corroborating it. You might get mugged. You know, there's all these different things. Whereas if you paid with Bitcoin specifically, you could say that 500 people had corroborated that they didn't send, you know, you bad drugs and that you were going to get your stuff shipped and that their reputation mattered really, 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 because one bad review, two bad reviews, and they, you know, the rest of the community wouldn't want to do business with them. So that's one I'll pass it.
Just quickly, the Silk Road as a tool for harm reduction was really powerful, exactly in the way that you're saying. And I've met several people who accidentally ended up with lots of Bitcoin. And three different people who had the Bitcoin from buying specifically DMT on the dark web. So I always think that's really interesting as well.
So the psychedelics function to sort of destabilize our normal power structure. In the West, we're all taught to not believe something unless there's hard proof. So the mind has to evaluate, negotiate. We've been taught not to really listen to our hearts, to our guts. And what psychedelics do is help decentralize that power structure and helps us learn how to feel into our bodies. You know, we're learning that, like, our emotional experiences are stored in our bodies on a physiological level. Psychedelics help us feel that. They help us unpack that. And so opening that door to, like, how psychedelics help us decentralize our personal power structures and how blockchain helps us decentralize power structures. And so we're no longer looking to the main head of the show running, you know, the director who's going to tell us what to do, the president who's going to tell us what to do, the man who's making us do the job. We are now learning how to be self-autonomous beings, choosing our own reality because we have a power structure that has smart contracts that ensures that there's less corruption, that ensures that we have a checks and balances system now. So, yeah.
Yeah, I'll go one step further on that and say that I think at the fundamental core of what these two different communities are trying to do, it's a very similar set of concepts. And that in both cases, you have someone out there who's telling you what you can think, what you can consume, how you should, you know, use money, which types of money are acceptable for you to use. And it's sort of a classic patriarchal system with someone who's like behind a desk somewhere with a bunch of pieces of paper and they're deciding those things. And what these types of technologies, I think of psychedelics as a technology to hack the mind and give us more direct experiences. They're both breaking out all of those layers and giving us the power as individuals to make those decisions ourselves. And I think in both cases, to what Liana was saying earlier, we're finding that concretely, empirically, scientifically, the result of that is way better than the old system that now we have. Originally, we couldn't have said that we necessarily had the data to show that. But today, we have the data to show that people who live in financially abundant ecosystems without middlemen, like, enjoy life better. They are more, you know, experience more financial flow. Things are coming to them. There's like a whole bunch of things that are coming there. On the other end, we're finding that people are releasing, you know, traumas and having a better overall state of mind. And so, and that, I think, what it's just the tip of the iceberg of a kind of wave that's coming and is going to crash down on mainstream society as that data just piles up and becomes blatantly obvious to everyone in the world that actually this system of a man behind the desk who tells you what you can do, not based on his own experience, but based on the piles of paper that are on his desk, is just not the best way to run anything. And so there's going to be a system change.
Yeah. Yeah, I think it's really fascinating that both of these movements are, you know, we're in the second psychedelic renaissance, so I can't say that psychedelics is emerging now, but there's a new movement that is emerging, and blockchain is an emergent technology, and there's all these synergies together in the ways in which they operate and work. And one thing that's important to point out is that there's always been a close tie between psychedelia and tech. So some of the early creators of the internet were heavily influenced by psychedelic experiences. The prime example is Steve Jobs, who said the second most important thing he ever did in his life was take LSD, right? And so you have the leaders of these huge organizations, Google everything, going to Burning Man every year, doing these things, exploring their consciousness. And the web itself, when you look at a map of it, looks very much like the neurological connections in our brain. And so we're seeing this, like, I feel like what we're designing right now in technology is directly referenced to the shape of the mycelial structures under our soil, the shape of our neurological connections, and the shape of our World Wide Web. And it seems to all be, there's like a biomimicry happening, and perhaps maybe we're developing a better way to mimic the functional relationships found in nature in our consciousness, and blockchain seems to be an expression of that. And another thing I'd like to point out and highlight is that MAPS raised $8 million from the cryptocurrency community this year, okay? So we've been working for many, many years on, we'll be the second nonprofit in history to pass a drug through the FDA. And why is that? It's because it normally costs $500 million to do drug development in my country and to get things through the FDA, which is part of why the pharmaceutical companies are just gouging everybody and making sure everybody's using their drugs regularly. They're not interested in curing you. They're interested in having you use their drugs regularly. And so we raised $27 million for phase 3 trials of MDMA-assisted psychotherapy. And we used to say, you know, we've done that all from the psychedelic community over time. And so we used to say that psychedelic therapy would be a gift from the psychedelic community to the world. And now I like to say that it's a gift from the cryptocurrency and the psychedelic movement to the world, because almost one third of our funding came from the cryptocurrency community. And it just goes to show that there's a deep relationship here. And some of the architects of this space are super pro psychedelics and are very heavily influenced by it. And that is a wish that I have for developing technology, that the experiences and the ethics and the core values that are inherent in this direct psychedelic experience inform the type of technology that we are creating so that it can increase our humanity, increase our compassion, and increase our connection to each other. Currently, technology has been developed with same as pharmaceuticals for a profit motivation, and that creates disconnection. And so a lot of what we're seeing right now and the negative feedback around some of our technological institutions is because of what it breeds in us, the disconnection. So I see blockchain as the opposite of that. It's a connective kind of tissue. It's like a membrane, you know, that can connect us all. So that's the potential that I see here.
And shout out to the Pineapple Fund for Pineapple that donation Fund to MAPS.
Absolutely.
And quickly on Pineapple Fund, raise your hand if you know about this anonymous Bitcoin donor who donated it ended up being like $86 million in Bitcoin to nonprofits. And so this person or persons or male, female, we don't know, but we did share, Rick Doblin, our founder, was able to communicate with this person over text, and they shared that they gave MAPS the first donation, and they had never heard of MAPS. We just like applied, we saw it on Reddit thread and applied, and the next day there was $1 million, which turned into $5 million in our account, which was crazy, right? But he said that he was severely depressed and he had all this wealth and resources and was severely depressed and suicidal and didn't know what to do with his life.
or their life. We think it's a he based on certain things, and that they ended up in ketamine-assisted therapy. So ketamine is currently legal in the United States for depression and suicidality. There's some questions around how that is executed, but he ended up doing ketamine therapy, and it was while he was on ketamine that he decided to give away $86 million in Bitcoin. So that's really interesting.
So I'll add a point about intentionality. So we now, through these technologies, blockchain and psychedelics, we have the ability to create what we want with a very specific intention and create the incentives of self-governing whatever types of technologies we want. We don't have someone else governing from top. We have to create the intention and the communities to govern itself, which is not easy to do. And we know that if we go fall back to top-down structures, we end up with the drug war, or we end up with central banking. And so intentionality of how we see these distributed collaborative organizations, as well as how we see the psychedelic society being used as a tool properly or improperly, and how we govern ourselves within those communities and weed out bad actors is really important.
Yeah.
So right now in LA, we just had a panel where we got, where Liana was on it. And it's, how do we regulate the psychedelic world when in lots of places this is illegal? We have to self-regulate and we have to self-monitor each other. We have to take care of each other. We have to make sure that, actually Liana, I know you have so much, yeah. Please run.
Yeah, no, it's been this problem has come up, right? Where bad actors in bad facilitators, right, who are taking advantage of people who are altered, right? So we had issues of sexual abuse in ceremony, right? And so these stories can totally derail all the good work and good effort that we're doing. And not to mention, it's the opposite. It gets so traumatizing to if somebody goes through something like that in an altered state. And so this question arose, well, what can we do as a community, right? How do we self-regulate? What are the structures and tools that we have to be able to do that? And so we had this really amazing panel, and it ended up being a community discussion around this. And one of the realizations that we had is that there are tools that we can develop using this blockchain technology, using certain secure identifying, things. I mean, you
contracts.
Guys are more technical, but anyways, there's an opportunity for this technology to benefit us directly in that way. And so we're working on some ideas right now and interested in the ways in which that will play out.
Yeah. These questions of self-regulation. These are questions that the blockchain and crypto community have been working on. That's kind of like the root of what it is, self-governance. What does that look like? And so this is one of the areas where, you know, if we bring these two worlds together, we can learn from each other. And I think this is one of the key areas where the psychedelic community, we can learn a lot just from talking to people who have been thinking about these types of questions already. And again, also, you mentioned intention. You know, in the psychedelic community, we're always talking about set and setting, and we've kind of known, like, hey, doing acid on its own is not going to make you enlightened, but depending on what's the mindset going in, what's your intention, what's the setting you're in, who's the facilitator, that can inform your experience in ways that can be healing or traumatic. And in the same way, blockchain is also a technology, and so what is the intention behind it? And so there are a lot of things where these communities can really learn from each other. Are there any other thoughts you have around self-regulation and intention?
Well, yeah, I mean, just that these are tools. Psychedelics are tools. They're not the silver bullet. They don't have all the answer. And in fact, the integration of the journey, in my opinion, matters more than the experience itself. So how we choose to pick up the tool, how we choose to show up to that experience, and what intention or what thought processes and what are set and setting is, all these things inform how the experience is and whether or not you're having a beneficial therapeutic experience, or if you can also create the conditions for a harmful experience, right? And the same is true for blockchain. And a lot of the negative feedback I hear about blockchain is, oh, people are just using it to get rich, and people are just using it, and the structures, the power structures are going to pick it up and use it. And it's the same truth applies to blockchain. It matters how we use it. And so the tools themselves are not the answer, but how we use them is what matters.
I would say that one lesson from the blockchain community on this topic is just the power of incentives. Mm. And really every blockchain design is built around the incentives for creating something to do a socially positive behavior for the sake of that particular network and figuring out what it is to make that overall system successful. And so many of successful systems have used a system where you don't just get a bunch of cryptocurrency or whatever, but you have to actually stake it. You have to put it in the system. You have to put it so that it's there for a significant period of time so that you have a long-term investment in what's happening there. And I think that there's a number of sort of principles, because a lot of these things, you know, are being discovered as we speak. It's in a formative stage by trial and error, by mistakes, but then they're evolving so rapidly that what happens at the other end of it is, again, way, way beyond what the dude with his, you know, piles of paper on his desk can ever even imagine was possible. And I think that within that sort of creative mindset, you know, all of these problems are addressable, whether it's, you know, the sexual abuse problem or, you know, the control of different types of substances that may be, you know, altered in some way inappropriately. Those are all very, very solvable problems within the context of the right types of incentives. And I think in general, every blockchain community that has come at it with that mindset has managed to create a really positive set of incentives that rewards people who are good actors.
Mm. Yeah,
I would just add that many of the incentive structures within our legacy institutions are misaligned. They don't actually represent what's best for the actual people around the world. The banking system allows for massive amounts of corruption and printing money and war and all these things, and it doesn't actually align what's great for the people if we were using that money for something else. And so the incentive structures in a self-regulating, intentional psychedelic community would also need to be set. How are you setting those incentive structures, and what are you doing to ensure that they are aligned as we move forward? Because otherwise we end up with the drug war, the top down.
Yeah, exactly. And go ahead.
Just on that note as well, I think it's really important to highlight that, sure, there's plenty of these crypto people who want to buy private islands and Lamborghinis and be very self-serving, but the fundamental core would be developing this technology, whether or not Bitcoin was worth one penny or $10,000. And that's really important to highlight. And the other thing here is that I'm noticing through evidence, through the support that we're receiving at MAPS, through the community, that there's new wealth that's been created on the planet. And so while there's some population of the people that are abusing that and doing whatever with it, and we see that on the news and that gets highlighted, what I see being involved in this community is that what these people are doing with their new amounts of wealth, with this like magical internet money that's kind of been come out of thin air, is they're reinvesting it into these projects in the future that we all believe in. And that's really inspiring to me, because like, we haven't had access to institutional capital. We don't have an ability to go to the traditional funding sources to do drug development, but yet there's this community that's like, we don't care. We're value aligned. We're mission aligned. We're all orienting towards the same North Star. And so I'm seeing a lot of these people that are newly wealthy focus their energies on that, and that's really inspiring to me.
I would add to that is that the kind of the original incentives that, you know, the people that got involved in Bitcoin in the first place, was it wasn't because they wanted to make money at all. They really wanted to say, hey, there's 3 to 4 billion people that have no way of trading with each other around the world in terms of financial inclusion with the rest of the world. They don't have any trusted way of doing that. And now there's a platform that potentially can scale the ability for everyone on the planet to connect and transmit value for free almost. And so the fact that actually makes a lot of money is good, because that means that we're actually providing resources to something that's going to be able to provide scalability to some of the world's biggest problems.
So on these guys through this crypto psychedelic conference, and for me, this was a new aspect to how blockchain could be used. This guy did a wonderful job of explaining how this restructures insurance and how this restructures, like, how Guardian is a program now that incentivizes people to take care of each other and good Samaritan behavior. I would love for you to explain that to everyone.
One of the biggest things, like I said, incentive structures is who's making money when, and how do we prove that, and how do we ensure that when someone takes care of something or something happens that's positive, that the people that do it are rewarded for that. For example, just in most of the insurance companies, like, you're not necessarily getting, if you're working out every day, you're not necessarily getting cheaper healthcare, right? If you're doing the proper things to incentivize things, you're not necessarily getting those things done. What was the specific?
The Guardian.
Okay, so Guardium is a peer-to-peer way of doing civil 911 response things around the world with the network. So there's an app, and if you're in trouble, you can incentivize people to come help respond, even if especially the trusted authorities are not trusted anymore. Guardium is a tool worldwide for anyone to be able to press a button and get aid for different types of you know, fire or medical or security services.
Yeah, and one of the things that got me initially inspired in blockchain was understanding the implications for the healthcare system, because currently, especially in my country, I mean, many of you Europeans have a whole other situation with healthcare, which I envy, but in my country, it's a sick care system. There's no incentive for doctors to keep you well. There's no incentive to go and do preventative medicine interventions ahead of time. It's a response. Our healthcare system is set up as a response to when you're ill, right? And so the potential is to do this peer-to-peer healthcare system where you're adding in your medical data and you're doing all the stuff. And I've been in lots of interesting brainstorming sessions around this, and there's a few projects that are looking to solve this, but it just goes to show that that's one system that's in massive need of transformation, and this technology can do that and put the power back in our hands.
Yeah.
Along those same lines, I just wanted to sort of talk a little bit about the psychology of the incentives and the finances, because I think one of the interesting things that is almost underappreciated is the difference in psychology between, you know, handling pieces of paper that came from a bank, you know, and that kind of when you give it to someone else or whatever else, there's a certain way that you perceive that, or that becomes sort of standard. And with a lot of these type of things, and for instance, Ether, which I, you know, was able to have some from the original founding of the Ethereum project, the psychology of that and moving it around is way different. And it comes into, you know, financing these type of healthcare projects and things like that, because it can just, it's so much easier to move it and, you know, take it there, that moving, you know, a amount of thousands of dollars feels like a breeze, you know, passing through, as opposed to all of the bits and pieces that are there for, you know, moving a freight truck from one thing to the next station. So in that sense, like, it, I think that psychological element adds on the ease that people in the blockchain community will go into something like a healthcare project or something like a personal protection project, because they perceive correctly that when they go out and create some sort of innovative idea or project, that then the finances are just going to flow to them very naturally. And so far in the system, that's very often been the case, that there is a sort of flow of finances.
Yeah, and one thing I'll add to that is that it's community driven, right? It's this whole concept of vote with your dollars on steroids, right? Because you invest in, or you put your energy into the things that you believe in. And the same is true within this community. So projects that are not useful and don't have this North Star orientation don't end up getting the funding that they need to execute. So there's this, like, very real-time thing happening where the projects that can service and benefit the most are the ones that are getting the funds that they need. And there's not that kind of, like, struggle with venture capital and institutions and things like that.
Yeah. So I'm really glad we're talking so much about this incentives question, right? Another way I would piggyback off of all these comments and frame it as our current financial systems are set up as wealth extraction. It's a very extractive process. How can I extract the most wealth out of anything? How can I prevent other people from being able to do it and extract the most wealth? Whereas what I think we want to create is a system that's based on value creation, which is a different thing. And so now we have the ability to create our own money, create our own economies, rewrite our rules, rewrite our incentive structures. So we actually have an ability now, collectively, to change the rules of the economy, to not be wealth extraction, but to be truly value creation. And in that, we can create incentive structures. And so in the psychedelic community, like we were talking about this question the other day, right, of and this question of bad actors, what do you do? We can potentially create marketplaces that incentivize the right people to come to the top, to have the right reputation. So there's a lot of, and we don't know all the answers. There's a lot of questions here, but a lot of really powerful stuff. I don't know if anyone wanted to reflect more on this.
Right. I mean, so with the psychedelic renaissance, second psychedelic renaissance coming in, there's going to be a massive influx of people that are investigating this for the first time. And so how do we put the people on top that have the most amount of knowledge that we want them, people to go to for the information versus people that are going to come in and try to be charlatans or try to be bad actors? So how do we incentivize the people with the most amount of knowledge that are good actors to be the ones that actually rise to the top in terms of the content or the where people go? I mean, just like I said, for example, it was Stephen Colbert interviewed Michael Pollan. And so that's tens of millions of people seeing what psychedelics potentially could do. So there's going to be a rush of people around the world that are going to go, hey, I want to try that. So where do they go? How do they get the resources? And how do we incentivize the right people for them to go to have a good experience? Yeah.
Cannabis is being legalized slowly throughout the United States, and a lot of the legislation that's passed hasn't really benefited a lot of the people who are mostly invested in it. What's happened is, you know, the man has come in again and run the old corporate structures, which isn't benefiting the system. So how do we utilize this information and make sure to usher psilocybin, which seems to be becoming legal, and in fact ending the drug war, how do we make sure that it's not again to the profits of the big corporations?
Yeah, exactly. And you know, right now the mechanism we have for bad actors, you know, so the big reason for the drug war is, hey, all these bad things that happen, and the mechanism is punishment, drug war, and that's our only mechanism. And so this question of incentivizing the right people to rise up is really important if we actually are serious about ending the drug war. And I think that's possible, and I think it's an important thing for us to try to start thinking about.
Yep.
Did you have another comment, or should we?
No, I think we should.
Yeah. Okay, yeah, so we can, we mentioned the Pineapple Fund. And I think that's a good segue into the topic of fundraising with crypto. And so it sounds like you want to say some things on
yeah,
that.
So yeah, so another analogy specifically is these community-based organizations can get funding from all around the world. So we can crowdfund anything we want. What are we going to crowdfund? And what types of structures, what types of communities are going to... So who's going to build the next project that's going to, you know, circulate that they want to get community support from everyone here or everyone around the world? How are they going to crowdfund those types of... So cryptocurrencies allow for you to do global crowdfunding at scale with no middleman. And so community-based projects that can have a lot of impact can get funding very quickly by making things, you know, go viral, sending out through communities, as well as we talked about kind of the corporate structures. Some of the new organizations that you can create on here and you can fund are called like DAOs, so distributed autonomous organizations, where they take the old corporate legal structure and they say, okay, you had the investors come in and they really just want to make sure that they get as much wealth out of the out of the company as possible. Let's take for Uber, for example. You have the drivers who really want to get paid the most amount of money, which is in direct conflict with the investors who want the most amount of money, right? And then you have the people that are actually in the drivers or the riders who want the cheapest and easiest fare, which is in direct conflict with the other two. So how do we create a distributed autonomous organization that kind of replaces a corporation that represents that serves a purpose to create what we wanted in this case, Uber, which is ride sharing, but we do it in a collaborative way that benefits everyone. And we do that with every single type of structure that we want to have in society. So whether it be a psychedelic, you know, science community, or whether it be a, you know, a bunch of shamans who want to share their organization, how do we create those types of apps and communities with this new distributed autonomous kind of organization funding mechanism?
I've been in multiple conversations with artists from this community that said that the by far the most art that they sold and the highest ticket art items had come from cryptocurrency. And Android Jones, who has a lot of stuff in the Visionary Gallery, was one of the earliest artists to accept Bitcoin, and he's told me that the things that people bought were often the higher ticket items that no one else bought, and that opening up that state of flow to be coming in from that world had greatly enhanced his own ability to do the projects that he wanted to take under his belt. And I think I've heard twice in the last 24 hours about even pieces at this festival that have been sold with cryptocurrency. And so just from that most simple level of opening yourself up to financial flow, I think that it's absolutely necessary to just anyone who wants to be receiving funds in any way for anything, open up the possibility to receiving cryptocurrency for that. Because there's just a lot of stuff that's out there that is ready potentially to flow into projects that you may already be working on and other people just don't know about. And as soon as they know about it, they will want to reciprocate and send it your direction. So I think at the fundamental level, that's like super exciting to me. And it's super exciting for me to see artists that I've known for years suddenly go from being, you know, at a bare level of sustenance. In fact, actually one of my favorite stories in the past year that actually turned into a sort of life purpose for me is some artist that I found that makes these psychedelic obelisks. And I bought one of them off of him like 2 years ago with some bits of Bitcoin and Ether. And then he took that, and he was living in kind of a not so great situation, sort of off grid. And he had always wanted to have like an electric car. He wanted to kind of participate in this type of world. And that once he kind of went into that world, he started exploring, and he was able to take that $1,000 and then over the course of 2 years, turned it into $100,000 and transformed totally the way that he was able to live. And he became, this is in Maui, an educator for the whole community there of how to live abundantly as an artist and share that kind of financial flow and information. And he's now going and helping walk through other artists and how to responsibly manage a cryptocurrency portfolio and all the little bits and pieces that you kind of have to learn. And I just realized personally that was like one of the moments of peak joy in my life ever, is seeing someone undergo that transition. Because, you know, and I think the Pineapple Fund is a good example of this. At some point, you have more money, you know, at least for some people, than they really know what to do with. And they want to see that, you know, kind of go back into projects that are building a new future in a kind of responsible way. They want to, like, empower other people, and they want to kind of be part of a larger community. And I think that there's a huge way in which the people in the cryptocurrency world, you know, which maybe not necessarily always the most socially adept, or may not always be maybe a little bit depressed and doing ketamine in a basement somewhere, actually really would love to engage with many of you and actually learn from you. And appreciate all of the kind of wisdom that you have collectively and the things that you've been doing. So I couldn't be more excited about how these communities are coming together at that level. Mm.
Yeah, and actually another example where fundraising with crypto, a very practical application of it, one that's near and dear to my heart. This is a new project, still kind of in idea phase and developing, but coming out of the Beyond Psychedelics conference that just happened in Prague about a month ago. So for those of you who aren't familiar, there are these organizations called psychedelic societies. There's maybe 80-some, like maybe 90-some now existing around the world. And these are already decentralized. There isn't like some central organization called the Psychedelic Society that runs them all. I started one in Baltimore and helped some in San Francisco, just a new one. Liana and I helped start in Porto, here in Portugal, a few days ago. And they're all over the world. These groups that are independently running, and these are communities where people are coming together, sharing information about what's happening in psychedelic science, helping each other integrate their own experiences, and also just having other people, finding the others that they can actually just talk to about this openly and honestly. One common thread among these psychedelic societies that's been a challenge is fundraising, right? These are mostly run by volunteers. These aren't people's jobs. People are just doing this as a side thing. And as it turns out, we can, and we're developing now a project which would raise crypto and then distribute it out to these organizations. What's the advantage to crypto over fiat here? You know, if we were gonna do a fundraising effort globally with fiat, we'd have to deal with, okay, what are we gonna incorporate? And how do we deal with currency exchanges? And all these really areas of friction. This is actually a very, very good use case for cryptocurrency, because we can have a global fundraising campaign and then in a very frictionless way distribute those funds to organizations, independent organizations all over the world. And so this is one project that's really newly in development that a few of us in the audience here are working on now. And so that's one example of a use case here.
To piggyback on that, also some of the attributes there is once you, let's say you wanted to seed fund, or you wanted to give a little bit of money to a specific psychedelic society to start up, and you say, okay, we're going to pay to make sure that you can, you know, rent out a venue and advertise in your local community and say, hey, we're going to put this meetup on. You can see exactly where the funds go. So let's say you wanted to give, you know, $100 or $50 to, you know, that community to start that up and give them a little bit of funding to ensure that they can go and do the community education that's necessary through cryptocurrency, because you can't, because the blockchain is a worldwide worldwide accounting ledger that we all can write to, but no one can go back and erase. You can see exactly where the funds go, so you can make sure that the funds aren't being used for something that it's not supposed to be, assuming you have ways of figure, you know, like within the community going, okay, well, they have a receipt here, they did this, and you can post that onto the internet and have ways of corroborating what was done with the funds and where.
So let's open up to questions.
Okay, so do you believe that it's important to kind of work with DEXs over centralized exchanges like Coinbase? Is that an important step forward? Because I'm working on a team now to build a cryptocurrency exchange, and this is the kind of thing that we're trying to decide if we should go down, say, working with 0x on the 0x protocol, or sort of do it centralized, which is a lot easier to get funding with.
I think in the ecosystem, there's place for both. And generally speaking, centralized exchanges have a higher degree of usability, and it's easier to, and more liquidity. And yet the decentralized exchanges are more robust. And so they have slightly different purposes associated with them. And as with anything that's sort of like building a business or a project, there is a bit of a strategic element in looking to see how populated the area is. So if there's exchanges already doing what you want to do really well, then it may not be the best thing. But if you happen to know that, like, I don't know, decentralized corn futures are a really big thing, or commodity markets, and no one's doing that, so, but you know all these people who really want to do it, then that can be a great kind of thing. So in some ways, it's less about the technology and more about the people who are going to be adopting the technology. And that is always changing in the world at large. And so it depends a lot on what you're going for.
I would add just that, you know, with there are centralized exchanges which make money off of buying and selling and making markets. There's a lot of decentralized liquidity or protocols that are coming out. Meaning, if you have a community currency, the community currency is only as good as far as your community goes. So if you have a local currency, you can't go to another place and use that currency. But with some of these, they provide the ability to have a community currency, but always be able to exchange it for something like Ether or Bitcoin whenever you wanted to use that community currency. So it makes it what's called liquid in that sense. I just add that.
And I will say that broadly, I'm a huge fan of things like 0x and the what they're taking, because it is a neglected thing. And I think it's easier in some ways to do the centralized exchanges and get them off the ground. But what the people who are building that sort of DEX infrastructure is a really needed thing in the space.
Hi, I'm Gus. Congratulations to you all. I really love all your interventions. Your interventions about this membrane uniting is all of us to the blockchain was amazing. Please repeat that and repeat that. My question is more related to centralization of the system itself, because let's remember that blockchain is also what you say is a book of accounting, an immutable book of accounting where you can program money. Okay, so the system, as the system it is today, he will like to use that because it creates a lot of efficiencies on that, and they are also very connected to our central government systems, okay? Which is make me believe that the system won't change because it doesn't want to change. Who runs the systems? Besides that, I think that it's more important to make people to create their own systems and to start like a competition among different systems. I just wanted to share that with you because you were talking about that, but it's also very important to remember us all that we are not are in a race. I mean, the internet itself was supposed to be decentralized as well. The very pioneers, the very people that were there at the beginning were having this kind of talks back then. And it didn't happen. It became Facebook, Google, that are making things very easy to people to fool them is another type of drug. Okay, they are drugging them with user experience and thing. So I think it's very important to remind people that this is about action. This is about action. This is about community engagement. This is about getting out of fear and talk about this. And guys, we can create our own things now. And that's it. Yeah, I would like to be in touch with you guys. As you realize, I do this kind of things too. So.
Yeah, thanks so much for saying that. The onus is on us. We determine the future of blockchain technology, all of us, all the people that get involved. And just like the internet, it could be taken over by corporations and go in that direction. The future is unwritten. So it matters so much, the intention that we have going into building these projects. All technology is imbued by the spirit of the creator, by the intention of the creator. And so much like, there's this whole transformational technology community that's emerged out of people who were whistleblowers at Facebook. There's the Center for Humane Technology. There's a really big effort underway now for people who are asking questions, how do we create technology that increases our empathy, increases our humanity, and helps us feel connected? I think I touched on this earlier. So this is going to require all of us to become engaged and involved if we want the outcome that we are all talking about and we are all dreaming into and we all desire. So thanks for bringing that up.
And I'd like to add that all the people that are running the big corporations, they see that they're not working, some of them, some of them understand that this is not good for the future of humanity. So some of them are helping. They also want to restructure. So there's reason for hope. Those people are fighting for us as well.
Yeah. And I guess one thing I would add, you mentioned, like, yes, the internet started off with these principles of decentralization and sort of became re-centralized in ways. And will that happen again with crypto? Probably. I mean, kind of to an extent has happened. Like, you can look at if there's big, big miners, you could look at that as a way of centralization coming back. I think to an extent, this is a process that just occurs naturally, right? These breaths happen, inhales and exhales of central and decentral. And I think to an extent, there's going to be a rhythm to it. To what extent can we be conscious about the rhythm we're in and where we are in that dance and where do we need to be? Maybe if we get too decentralized, there can be such a thing as too much decentralization. And at that point, we might need some kind of centralization there to help kind of coordinate things and pull together. So I just put out there might be a rhythm to it.
Definitely can be too much decentralization. Because if you don't have most of these, even these decentralized cryptocurrencies, they all start as a centralized planned, hey, we're going to create this and we need to ensure that we create the safe container for our intention as it moves forward. Mm-hmm. And then we allow the community to develop around it with these guidelines that we've set so that with the community, it doesn't just end up being destroyed by bad actors in the beginning. So there can be definitely too much decentralization. And centralization in terms of making executive decisions to ensure that, hey, this is the path we want to go on versus having infighting is can happen a lot.
Yeah, and just the one point I want to add is that we were at the very, 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 very beginning, okay? So this is like, it's the 90s and we just invented the internet and we have no idea how to use it or what it's going to be used for or what shape it's going to take or what a search bar. I mean, like the first search application for the internet was this thing called Mosaic, right? And so before that, people were like, oh, cool, this thing, it does this cool thing, but we don't know how to use it. And so I just want us all to remember that we are just at the very, very beginning of this movement. And I think it's really interesting and exciting that communities like this one are becoming so engaged, because I think that we hold a vision that is really important for the time in the world right now. And so if we can keep that in mind and work together and become engaged in this process, I'm really hopeful.
Thank you.
Okay,
let's get a question over here. This guy's had his hand up for a long time.
Hey guys, thanks first of all so much. This is a really stimulating discussion. My question's a bit general. I would be curious from some of you about your kind of entrepreneurial or project wish list. So like, if there's a group of people who have access to a few million dollars and a good team, what are some of the things that come to mind that really need to be done to take these things a step forward?
Great question. Cool. Let's start. Well, I'll speak to some projects I'm working on. So one of my projects I've currently been building is called Psychedelic Seminars, and the idea is it's a combination of in-person and online events, particularly engaging in the psychedelic community and going deeper into some of the questions and some of the nuances. You know, as mentioned, it's not so simple as just evangelizing and saying, hey, psychedelics are going to save the world. There's a lot of questions. And so creating the platform to have nuanced conversations about psychedelics and what are the emerging challenges as psychedelics come into the society. So I'm currently looking to expand that project out and bring on other hosts, more video editors, et cetera. So that's a project I'm working on. If someone's interested in that, I would love to talk to you.
So we've been talking also about bringing together all the different psychedelic societies and creating a framework and structure where we can strategize all our efforts that are happening all around the world so that we're not being redundant, so that we're being strategic about what we're doing so that we can create results as fast as possible. So I can see there being a need for support and help for helping create this coalition so we're as effective as possible. And I'm going to do a little self-plug. The Healing Powers of Psychedelics and Other Mindful Practices, this show is releasing August 8th through Mary Jane, Snoop Dogg's media company. Their demographic isn't exactly our demographic, so trying to elevate this and make sure that the right audiences are getting the right understanding around how these tools can be used is essential. So if anybody wants to be a part of that, hashtag the healing powers, please connect.
I guess if there were pre-existing teams with financing that were looking for sort of projects, I would just highlight some of the key areas that have already been mentioned up here. Healthcare, personal data privacy and communication, things that are in that sort of fundamental human rights kind of protection category. Insurance, things that kind of go alongside sort of peer-to-peer networks in general. I personally am really interested in participating in things that are more to taking things that are in a small but vibrant community and then bridging it into traditional financial markets. And I think I mentioned art before. I think that we're ripe right now for taking some of this amazing art that's being created in this community and then bridging it into some of those traditional kind of market infrastructure that has existed. So, you know, a lot of these things, in some ways, I would take something that you have a high degree of personal passion and vibrancy about, and then look at, you know, what someone is already doing well or what you're already doing well, and then what are the next steps to kind of bring it to a larger audience.
Well, I'm a political animal. I've been an activist for all sorts of things, an advocate my entire life, and have done a lot of lobbying Congress and that sort of thing. And so I'm very curious about ways in which we can utilize this technology to influence and upgrade our democratic processes. There's all sorts of new governance structures that are emerging in this way. So collaborative governance is an area that I'm really fascinated by. In addition to that, I'm always looking at all the healthcare solutions coming out, the data solutions coming out, all these things that can be really useful and applicable in our efforts to safely onboard millions of people to psychedelics, which is really my and others' ultimate goal in the work that we're doing now. So those are kind of some of the core things. There's something called the Special Economic Zone, which is a special commercially zoned area, which means that the area can write their own commercial law. So there's special economic zones set up all over the world. Hong Kong is a famous one of those. So that is to say that the legal institutions that govern exchange between people have separate laws than the national federal institution. And so there's different projects and efforts underway right now with different special economic zones that are working on designing new kinds of governance. And I think that we have a lack of choice in governance. And I'm really curious to see what comes out of that. And I think that if we were able to opt into governance, that perhaps things like the drug war wouldn't be part of our reality in those situations. So, yeah. Matt has the longest list of projects out of any of us that he's currently advising on. So I don't know if you want to run through some of them, but
there's too many. So decentranet.com is the website. There's a lot of different projects. We do mostly projects on global impact, so energy, healthcare, financial inclusion, psychedelic science, and mental health. One of the biggest one that's kind of like taking on the financial infrastructure is kind of Good Money, which is a project that's allowing for going to take on the kind of the central banking system and allowing for an app that everyone around the world can use. And by participating in the app, you as a giant community can direct resources at scale to impact projects that you want to see happen. So goodmoney.io is the one that I'll plug for now.
And from my own little portfolio, since we're plugging projects, there are two projects here that I invested in because I thought they had a high degree of personal integrity and something that they had done already that was really beautiful, and you know, expanding consciousness and, you know, transitioning into being a really abundant and amazing kind of business model. One of those is microdose, which you guys may have seen in the Visionary Art Gallery. I think that that type of virtual reality experience is so clearly the future in so many different ways, and also has a way of being like a transformative of impact for a kid that can play and dance in virtual reality and create all these things without necessarily needing to be in a super safe container or have some psychedelics or anything else like that. So I love that project. I also have been helping with the New Mundo project, which is involved, you know, in kind of networking intentional communities and bringing kind of land assets online and allowing to kind of create a global network of all of those communities. And that, I think, is just a tremendously impactful thing for the world right now. And anything that brings different intentional communities around to come together around a new economic reality that is going to kind of lift everyone up collectively is just something that I couldn't be more excited about and definitely want to help out in any way possible.
And the people from New Mundo are here. Yeah. So, yeah. And they're amazing. Yeah. Right there, David and Sarah. All right.
Okay. So I have a quick. Well, I don't know, but quick. I have a question about breakthrough experience, but not the psychedelic one. But let's go about crypto psychedelic one. I have a feeling that a lot of what we're talking about is not close enough to action, and I feel that when we operate within psychedelic and crypto space, we still interact way too much with what is already there. Right, you know, we still go through the FDA, we still want to get published in the journal, we still want to interact with government. But what I feel crypto and psychedelic gives us is an ability to break through from all of that. Right, you don't need FDA to publish the biggest paper ever written, and you don't need to publish in the biggest journal to actually spread, because if you publish it under your name on Medium, it will spread faster and better, right? So what's stopping you guys as a group, for example, right now to create, and I feel like psychedelic research is the most lacking space. We need much more research in it. What's preventing a group of people to create a system for creating research that would bypass all FDA, the 10 years of research, and publish it right now, next year, by using the whole world to actually build something like that?
Thanks. I think that's a really inspiring point, and the potential for that is emerging. One of my core values in both of these movements is seeing this as a yes and, right? So there is no us versus them. There is no other. There is no enemy here, you know? I've been moving away from seeing these movements as disruptive and understanding them to be constructive and for the benefit of mankind and all of the world. And so what I'd really like us to focus on, and I look for blockchain projects that are doing this, is how to transition the current systems into a new way. And I think that we're in a transition period, and so it's a yes and. Yes, we do want to pass this through the FDA and get that legitimacy and get the science done it just gives us so much power and influence to be able to do that. And I would really like to see people come together and raise a boatload of money so that we can go out and study all the different things that we're looking at in terms of the ways that psychedelics, I mean, we think that ibogaine causes neurogenesis. Like, I want to study that. You know, we think that there's just so many different ways to approach this. So I don't really see it as a mutually exclusive thing. And in fact, I think that it would be really important. It's important to all of us that we take the steps and build and put the bricks on the road of the path to walk all of humanity with us over into these new ways and new systems, you know? There's this Buckminster Fuller quote that in order to create the future we dream of, we have to create a system that makes the old one obsolete. And I've been a huge believer in that, but I'm also wondering about the system that transitions us from the old to the new and who's going to create that. And so I'm very interested in working at it from that angle.
Exit ramps. Huh? Exit ramps.
Exodus.
Exit ramps.
Yeah.
Building in parallel.
I'm going to partially disagree with that comment, and because I like forests, and forests have a way of treating, you know, the ecosystem over time, and that is occasionally there's a forest fire, and it burns out some of the old wood that's not really serving the forest anymore. And I think that's a natural process, happens in nature over and over again. And I don't have a problem with it. I think there's lots of things that, you know, occasionally need to get burnt out in a constructive way. And you know, the sooner that we can build, and I also think competition, kind of to the point before, between different systems can be very healthy and very beneficial to everyone involved, because it's kind of creating this additional layer of accountability and everything else. So, you know, creating a psychedelic science research journal that is going out there, whatever the structure of it might be, that is pushing the envelope on there, you know, may, you know, create a little bit of a conflict and competition with pre-existing things, but that could be very healthy for everyone involved. And I would love to support a project like that.
Yeah. And I guess another answer I'd give to this question is I think it's already happening. I don't know if you meant specifically the science, but in parallel to the science is this cultural end of it, is helping our culture build a more mature relationship to these things. As has been mentioned, we've known about the healing powers of psychedelics forever, and now we're kind of just like, you know, proving it with the system. And in parallel to that, you know, my own work curating events like this, or more broadly for people around the world that are running psychedelic societies, no one, you know, me, myself, and others that are doing this kind of work, the cultural end of it, we didn't get permission from the FDA, we're just doing it. So this is happening. It is happening right now.
Yeah, and I guess just one thing I'll quickly add about my concern about our transitionary period is that the same populations that are disproportionately negatively impacted by our current legacy system stand to be disproportionately negatively impacted by new systems unless we take a deep consideration of and understand that there are populations that rely on some of the infrastructure that's there today, social welfare programs and things like that. And so I do know some blockchain projects that are in the works right now that are looking to solve those types of problems for our society. And I'm keenly interested in how to navigate through all of that so that we're not repeating the same patterns and mistakes from our past.
Yes, that's a very good point.
Yeah, I'll kind of just say building these systems in parallel is really important. One of the reasons I got into the cryptocurrency space in the first place was 2008. There was a giant collapse, potential collapse of the entire world financial system, and it made it very apparent to a lot of people that the old system was teetering on collapse. And so how do we build a new one? And that's where Bitcoin came out that very year. And so these financial systems are being built, these governance systems are being built, and then we can start to have all these different applications for both systems.
Yeah, we've got time for maybe one or two questions. You've been waiting for a while.
Yeah. Yeah, interesting talk. Thank you. It's a very simple question I had, and it came from when you were talking about, say, psychedelic societies and being funded by cryptocurrency. And how also you're saying it can be monitored where the money goes. But on a practical level, if you have a society and they're booking a venue and things like that, they're not going to be, most venues don't take cryptocurrency. They want traditional forms of money. So I'm, you know, in my mind, I'm just thinking, well, how does this work? And you know, aside from not being able, would you still be able to track it if they've been paying for cash for it? So that's the question, really.
Right, you wouldn't. And so you would, you know, liquidity is something that's important. But if you, there are local vendors that will do exchanges for you, like cash for cryptocurrencies, you can do it that way and finding venues or finding stuff. You can also, in a lot of these collaborative communities, you can have requirements for the funds to be released where, let's say, someone submits a proposal and then there's people on the ground that can help check that those things were done before the funds are done. It's still very, very, very new, and the technological ability and the is still, you know, still being built.
Yeah.
We're in building mode, and I'm excited to also report that I have found venues that would take cryptocurrency. And so that's the other thing, is that maybe we can encourage the community to develop around us as we start to utilize these things in this new way. Yeah. So, but it, again, these are very, very new. We're at the very, very beginning of all of this right now.
Yeah, exactly. So we don't have it all yet, but there was a time when when we're talking about electric cars, for example, right? And there were questions like, well, how do you charge your car if you're driving across the country? At the time, there wasn't such a thing. Today, actually, you can charge your car. There are stations where you can do that. So the infrastructure is still being built, and it will emerge as cryptocurrencies are more used. And using these currencies for these types of projects will kind of help to build that. Another answer to your question is, there's a lot of open questions that we don't know the governance of what this is going to look like yet. Yeah, how do we validate how a psychedelic society spent its money? Do they have to send a photo of the event they did? Or I don't know. This is a brand new project, and it's still very much being developed right now. And there's a lot of open questions around governance that we have to figure out.
And for those of you who are new to blockchain talk, you know, this is a ledger system of transactions, and it is built on the idea that there's smart contracts that hold us accountable. So when this was first explained to me, I thought, my God, this isn't an end to corruption if we design the framework correctly. So I see a great need for people to help us build those frameworks. When we talk about building a unified, like, psychedelic society, we need help building those frameworks, help writing those smart contracts so that that accountability is a huge part of being successful.
And if people want to help us develop these answers to these questions, if you've got expertise in governance structures and communities and these kind of questions, we have a Discord channel for this project, and you can get added to it if you want to help contribute ideas to this project or skills, expertise. So come talk to me if you're interested in helping us figure this out. Discord. It's kind of like Slack, if you're familiar with that. Psychedelic Community Crypto Project, but you'll need an invite link to get in, so you'll have to come talk to me. Yeah, PCCP.
Take a question over here.
Let's do the
question. Do you need to wrap up?
Hi. Thanks so much for the talk so far, guys. It's actually been really interesting. I'm very limited in terms of experience of blockchain and its applications. So some of the questions that I have, I've got two questions, or one a talking point and one question, maybe. But so it's actually building off what you guys were just talking about. I'm somebody without necessarily technical skills or ability to contribute to the projects, but I am a punter, right? So I have money, I spend it to live my life. Are there areas that are, from the mainstream use of money and economy, that I can kind of tap into and start putting my business through those means to support them in terms of having the flow of capital go through them, if that makes sense? Because you said that you found events that will take cryptocurrency. Do you know of sectors that we can look out for that are closer than other sectors to providing us this kind of hookup to interact with cryptocurrency in this way?
I would say, you know, it's very easy for you to accept cryptocurrency payments online. Coin payments does it. You can add a widget to your website and you can accept it. Anyone in the world can do that. So that allows for hundreds of cryptocurrencies to be accepted by anyone with a website. So that's one really easy to do one.
So it's almost the case of getting cryptocurrency yourself and spending it when you make purchases online instead of using your normal account in that sense.
Right. So anyone in the world would be able to, if you had a business online, would be able to pay in a cryptocurrency with that. That's one of the things. Another one that it's not that, but specifically these decentralized kind of community currency platforms, such as like Bancor, which allow for, let's say, any cryptocurrency that you create, or any community-backed currency that you create, doesn't need to go through some exchange to be converted back into the base one, which is Ethereum. So that's one of the things that allows you to create whatever structures you want underneath the community that you're designing.
I just want to quickly add, I'm not technical at all, and I appreciate and understand a lot of this stuff from a more theoretical point of view. And one of my like common feedback to all my friends over here is we need UX, right? We need the user-friendly way for everybody to get engaged and get involved. And there's some of these stuff emerging, and unfortunately, the most user-friendly systems are not the most advanced in terms of advancing our overarching values and ethics and goals, like Coinbase, for example. But I will say again that this is early and that There's a lot of development happening right now. There's so much money that's flowed into developing projects. I believe that a good portion of them will fail, much like the early internet bubble. And then the few that succeed will totally change and transform the world, right? And so it's a little bit difficult to, I think you're looking for like, what can I do? What's like user friendly? What's like easy for me to plug into? And the hard truth of that is that it's not super simple right now, but it's getting easier every day. So just keep your ear on the ground, keep paying attention, and yeah, maybe you guys have some like good media channels you want to share with people as well for paying attention to projects. Like Cointelegraph or...
Cointelegraph. 101 stuff, blockgeeks.com is a really good one. It has a lot of just regular knowledge about all these things, articles written in plain language that I really like. Not specifically project-based, but just learning the lingo, because there is obviously a language that is being developed in real time about how we kind of describe a lot of these tools. And it was designed by cryptography nerds, right? A lot of the language. So it's not designed for the person that's never looked at it before. But it's up to you to kind of build the UI UX for your communities. That's going to be ultimately have to come from the people that the app or the community is being built for. Mm-hmm. So you have to take that feedback in, because it can't just be some guy goes, oh, this is the way you're going to use this app. Well, no, it has to have some community feedback.
Yeah, that makes sense. Well, there's also projects like Giveth that will make it easier. And it's still in development now, but will make it easier for communities. Potentially, this project could go on there to have user-friendly ways of creating governance and managing a fund, for example.
Giveth.io.
Giveth.io. Do we have time for, I think, probably one more question?
Yeah.
So I don't know where the question microphone is.
I've got a question over here.
All right. Where is
I don't think we talk enough about how crypto is generated. There is a concept in cryptocurrencies called proof of value, which is used to create new currencies and put them into the system. And nowadays, at least for Bitcoin and Ethereum, I can say that this process demands a lot of energy, a lot of power. I don't think this subject gets enough attention, as it consumes energy, and it's a work that's relatively worthless, in the meaning that it's like hiding something randomly and telling people to find it. And when, after a lot of work, they find it, they're rewarded with cryptocurrency. So what do you guys think about the impact and the environment, about how we generate value and how cryptocurrencies, how the proof of work works?
That's a really good question. So proof of work, which is what Bitcoin and Ethereum are designed to operate off of, as a consensus mechanism, as a way of figuring out what is the universal ledger that we're all sharing, and how do we incentivize to ensure that no one can come and corrupt that ledger. So how do we create the incentives to do that? And so right now that takes a lot of energy and work, because we're fundamentally disintermediating all banks. Banks keep our records, corporations keep our records, governments keep our records. So, you know, what is the total sum of energy that you needed to keep all of the records from the record keepers, and to sign the transactions and to verify the transactions? So we're starting to disintermediate that. Another thing that I'll say is that some of the cheapest forms of energy now, we're hitting a tipping point where they're becoming sustainable energy systems, such as wind and solar. And so with Bitcoin specifically, there's 12.5 Bitcoins that are being generated every 10 minutes. And now that becomes a bounty program for engineers to build on the cleanest forms of energy, so the solar, and say 12.5 Bitcoins are being generated every single 10 minutes, to figure out who can develop the most efficient solar system in the world and plug their Bitcoin miner into it. So that's a pretty good incentive structure to build solar and wind energy systems. So it does take a lot of energy. We're disintermediating all record keepers, and we're now having an incentive structure for anyone in the world to have a bounty program to have, you know, a solar energy and plug their thing into the grid?
I think that's a great set of points, and a lot of it just depends on comparing, you know, what it is versus what came before. You know, the previous financial system of the world depended on gold, and there's a huge cost in protecting gold and maintaining gold. If you include in land registries and contracts, then every nation in the earth has like standing militaries that protect the pieces of paper that enforce where the borders are. And imagine the cost of that system. It's massive, right? So we're making progress slowly. And I think that is a great area for people. We were talking about where to put energy. That's a huge issue that people are aware of. Vitalik Buterin, who is the founder of Ethereum, said it was one of the issues he was most concerned about in cryptocurrency. And many of the people in that community and other cryptocurrency researchers have been spending a lot of time and energy on how to develop better systems that are more energy efficient. So I'm very hopeful that one of them will break through in the next couple of years.
Securing freedom takes work. It really does. And the global community can kind of contribute to disintermediating all of those. I mean, the global kind of financial system currently is the petrodollar, right? It's based on basically a token for oil around the world and all the wars that are fought for oil. So transitioning into something that isn't based on oil and the trillions of dollars spent in protecting different types of oil is well worth our energy resources.
Yes.
Yeah, I just want to say that all this, the future that we are building is unwritten, and it depends on all of us to come together and collaborate. And so we're definitely going to do the wrong thing at some point and make mistakes and have to course correct and iterate from there. And so I want us to all be very compassionate with ourselves. I want us to all understand that this is like, it's all or nothing right now. And we have a huge amount of potential in front of us. And so it matters what we choose to do with that. And so I just want to create an invitation to each of us to join the movements that you're in already being here at Boom, the movements that are emerging, because it's your influence matters and your opinions and your perspective matter. And that's really what's going to help shape what we're building. So that, and then if anyone, you know, supports psychedelic science, it's changing the world. So there's organizations like MAPS. MAPS is probably one of the better known ones. But do everything that you can to help support the total renaissance in mental health. We have 300 million people suffering from depression globally right now. It's the number one cause of disability. And so there's a huge amount of potential for these medicines to come in, and when done responsibly, it can totally transform the way that we show up in the world within ourselves and with each other. So that's it. Thanks.
And to piggyback on that, how we ourselves represent this culture is really a big part of it. If we can start being more vulnerable about our own difficulties, our own emotional struggles, our depression, our anxiety, and we share this with others, we make it more acceptable to start having this conversation. We make it more apparent that there's a need for this solution. It's no longer we're shaming, oh, we have these emotional issues and we wait till it becomes such a big problem that it takes over our lives. It's more like, hey, this is part of my path, and I'm celebrating it and I'm sharing it with you. I'm being vulnerable. If we can do that more and more, this is opening the doors for everyone, and we can all just get on the road to healing.
I'll just add that you should go out and download a Bitcoin wallet, learn how it works. We talk a lot about the theory here, but going and learning about it and then teaching your neighbor on how to do it is really important. But I would definitely say that we're on to something really big here. You know, I'd say the future is very crypto psychedelic. So.
Yeah.
Cool. Woo. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.